Seeing on the question of whether China wants itself to be an Arctic country is a it's basically a null question, because by definition, China is not in the Arctic Circle, and China is not one of the 8 Arctic states. So even if China wants to argue that it has a stake in the Arctic region, it's very difficult, literally impossible, for China to argue it is an Arctic country. So understanding that drawback or that weakness of China's identity by being a non-Arctic state, I think the Chinese came up with a quite sophisticated and smart way to make this question not a binary question, that the countries in the world are not divided into two groups, Arctic countries and non-Arctic countries. Instead, the Chinese developed a third category called near-Arctic state, which means that China is geographically close enough to the Arctic region that China has a significant stake in the development and the future of the Arctic region. But in reality, China knows very well that it is not an Arctic state, and it cannot claim the title and the status as such. Well, China since 2013 has been elected a member, basically as an observer of the Arctic Council. So what that literally means is that it gives the Chinese the right to observe, to participate in the meetings and sessions of the Arctic Council, but China doesn't have a say. So to have a seat in the room is different from having a seat at the table. So China has successfully got itself into the room of the Arctic Council, but it does not yet have a seat at the table. So that actually has created quite a lot of frustration in China about its Arctic policy and about its role on the Arctic Council, because as an observer, China does not have the voting rights, and it does not have the ability to set agenda. It does not even have the ability to, well, it has the ability to express its opinion, but it cannot vote basically on the Arctic Council. So this type of frustration, I think, has created a lot of anxiety on China's side as well how to circumvent the obstacles as an observer on the Arctic Council. And they have successfully come up with other ways, such as bilateral cooperation with individual Arctic states and cooperation through economic endeavors, such as the Polar Silk Road, to basically interject to instill Chinese influence in Arctic affairs, but without having to go through the Arctic Council every time.